Okay, so my TED Talk today is going to be a little bit of a change of pace than what we've been hearing. And I decided to start out by telling you who these people, that guy has a bit of a creepy smile, who he is. So the couple on the left is Richard and Hella Crafts. They're a married couple. They have three children, and they live in Newtown, Connecticut. And they met because they're both flight attendants for Pan Am Airlines. And then there's another picture of him on the right, too. So what I'm about to tell you is very important. On November 19th, 1986, it was around Thanksgiving time, obviously, and there was a big snowstorm going on in the Newtown area. And this was the day when Hella supposedly flew to see her sick mother. And so Richard had planned to kill his wife for a while at this point. I know things escalated quickly. So he sent his kids and their nanny to his sister's house in Newport. And so many of you might have a follow-up question, why would he want to kill his wife? That's a good question. So it's because of their troubled marriage. And at this point, that is not Richard, but he had had cancer a couple years before, and that had put a lot of strain on their relationship. And so Hella had been picking up on that and paying particular attention to that. So previously, she had paid all the phone bills, the house, electric, everything. And one day, she noticed on the phone bill there was multiple calls to a long-distance number. And so she was picking up on that, and Richard saw her suspicion, and he took all the bills away and said, I'll be paying them from now on. And so his trips were getting longer, all the phone calls, she was really suspicious. And so she knew that the only way to figure out if he was actually cheating on her was to hire a personal investigator and take it into her own hands. So on the screen is Keith Mayo. He is the personal investigator that she hired. And so she knew that he was the only option and he would soon prove her suspicions correct. And at this point, Hella knew that divorce was the only option. So these pictures, as you can tell, were taken from Keith Mayo's car because of the lines on the pictures, and it's of Richard and his mistress. And so when Hella found this out, she knew that there was only one option, it was divorce. And so Richard needed to have every aspect of his murder plan perfect if he planned on getting away with it. And he told all of Hella's friends that she flew to visit her sick mother, like I told you before. And so Hella had every intent of asking for divorce, and she told all of her friends, all of her coworkers, if something happens to me, no, it wasn't an accident. And so she said this because she knew Richard's behavior tendencies and knew what he was like and had an uneasy feeling about it. And so the story that Richard was telling all of her friends caused a lot of suspicion, but they didn't have any hard evidence that he was doing anything to her, so they couldn't really take any action. And so the kids were with Hella's sister one night, and they got in an argument before bed, and Richard hit her across the head with the weapon. Is still unknown to this day, but they think it was a police flashlight, and then she was unconscious, and he hit her again, which ended up killing her. And he put her body in the freezer in the garage, and once he was frozen, he knew that he had to put her body along with wood chips and a wood chipper. And so this is a picture of the saw, and on the top right, it's another picture of part of the saw with all of her blood on it. And on the bottom is the wood chipper that he used to run through it. And so, on the left is a picture of the Housatonic River on a normal day, and on the right, it's with all the snow during the snowstorm. And so Richard left his house at 2 a.m. to go bring all of the remains to the Housatonic River, and obviously because there was a snowstorm, there was plow drivers out, and usually when you see a truck with a wood chipper, a little suspicious at 2 a.m., and so when the plow driver was questioned by the authorities, he ended up bringing them to that spot, but Richard was unidentifiable because he was so bundled up because of the storm. And so he brought all the remains of her body there and the wood chipper and put it along with the wood chips through, and he tried to get it all in the river, but some ended up ending on the riverbank. And so when the plow driver brought them to the river, they found all of the remains on the side, and then that led them. They sent a bunch of scuba divers into the lake, and they found all the rest of her remains. And so a really interesting fact is the plow driver ended up being a key part in the investigation, and his wife used to babysit for the Crafts kids, the children, which is really interesting. So now these are all the evidence. Everything I'm about to show you is the only pieces of evidence that they found of her body. So this is a picture of her tooth, which they matched with her dental records to figure out was her. And then this is the the only bones that they found. And then on the left is a picture of her hair, and as you can tell, girls have a lot of hair typically, and then on the right is it zoomed in on a microscope, and the only thing that was not pictured is they found a part of her nail with red nail polish on it, and they compared it to her nail polish at home to figure out that it was her. And so at this point, technically, she was only a missing person because they didn't have her actual body. And so some of you guys might be wondering why I know all of this and how I have all of these pictures. And so my relation to the case is that my mom's father, my grandfather on the top left, is Walter D. Flanagan, and he was the state's prosecuting attorney on this case. And it was his enthusiasm when talking about this case that made me want to research it. And so my grandfather, grandmother, and their five children lived in Fairfield, and my grandfather was the state's attorney in Danbury. And so that's me with him in his office on the bottom right. And he gave me all the evidence, pictures, and personal stories that you guys are hearing today. And so these are pictures from the court. On the left is Richard in court, and on the right is my grandfather handing evidence to the nanny. That's their nanny. And so she testified because he took her out of the house at the middle of the night on a snowstorm. And so she testified about like his behavior tendencies and everything like that. And so my grandfather also gave me all the newspaper clippings, which I thought was really interesting. So one of these is from 1986 and the other is from 1987. So it shows kind of how long the case went on and how important it was. You really couldn't pick up a newspaper without seeing something about this. And so it was all like, at this point, they didn't know. So it was like missing or murdered, and they were trying to figure all of this out. And so I wanted to give you guys an update on the case. So to this day, this was the first murder to ever be solved without a body. And Richard's trial was a hung jury. The first time it was tried, it was a split vote, and so they had to try it again. It was really frustrating for my grandfather because everything was set up, and then when it had to be tried again, it was a whole different process, so it was really drawn out. And Richard Crafts is currently in prison. He wasn't sentenced to life. He was sentenced to 53 years, so he will be very old towards the end of his term. And he's in Enfield right now, but my grandfather said that he's moved around a lot because he's an escape threat and knowing like how deceitful he is. And the Kraft kids were put in custody of Richard's sister, but they're much older now. They're close to their 30s. And since the case had been closed, there was a book published about the murder right there. And Henry Lee was also the lead forensic on this case, and he published a book about it, and my grandfather has mentioned a lot in that. And then on the right, there was a Forensics Files episode made about it, which was really interesting if you guys want to watch that. And to this day, it was a really landmark forensic case, and I thought it was really interesting. So I hope you guys learned about this, and that's my story.